Tau katoa e hui hui mai nei. E nā mana whenua no Aotea, tēnā koutou. E nā mana whenua katoa e tamaki makaurau, tēnā koutou. E nā kaitiaki o Glenfern Sanctuary, tēnā koutou. E oku hoamahi o te kaunihira, tēnā koutou. Nau mai, haere mai koutou katoa, ki tēnei kōrero tuihono nā Chris McDowall, korenei o tōku ingoa. E mahi ana au hei paukokiri I ngā pātaka kōrero o Tamaki Makaurau. Greetings and welcome everybody to this online talk today by Chris McDowall. Shortly I'll hand over to Chris, who will share his experience and the work he created during his time as Auckland Council's Artist-in-Residence at the Glenfern Sanctuary on Aotea Great Barrier Island about this time last year. After Chris has spoken, we'll have time for questions. Before then, we ask that you keep your cameras and microphones off, and when we come to the end of the talk, we'll talk about how that process will happen. So, a bit about Chris. Chris trained as a geographer with a focus on cartography and human geography. He's worked as a cartographer, as an environmental scientist, manager at the University of Auckland, Land Care Research, the National Library of New Zealand and figure.nz, and he's currently a very busy data journalist for the New Zealand Herald. He's also the co-creator of an award-winning book, We Are Here, an Atlas of Aotearoa. It's a great pleasure to be able to introduce Chris today, in part because we've had to reschedule this talk several times over the past year, but mostly because his work has passion, integrity, and skill. And I truly can't wait to hear and see more about what he made at Glenfern. Nō reira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Over to you, Chris.
Kia ora, thank you very much for that kind of introduction, Renee, for inviting me to talk. And I'm glad that we can finally do this. There's been several false starts this year as we've gone in and out of different lockdown levels, and even though those of us who are in Auckland or in Northland or Northern Waikato are in level three, we're able to get together through the magic of Zoom. So I'm going to talk about what I did for a couple of months last year, October and November, as the Auckland Council Artist in Residence. And I'm going to talk about mapping and map making. And very specifically, I'm going to talk about the Glenfern Sanctuary, which is an amazing place, and Kōtuku Peninsula, and the wider Aotea Great Barrier Island. First, though, I'd like to just acknowledge a few organisations and also some people. So I'd like to acknowledge Auckland Council, especially the parks, and especially Michelle Edge and her amazing, the amazing Artist in Residence program that she runs. I'd like to acknowledge the Glenfern Sanctuary and the Glenfern Sanctuary Trust, who were so supportive of me all throughout, and it's really good to be able to start returning some of that, I hope, now and over the coming months as this work comes to fruition. As part of that, I guess also the various family and friends of Tony Pizade who made time for me and for different sorts of generosity that they offered. I'd like to thank Auckland Council Libraries, Auckland Libraries, who are part of the council, of course, for hosting this event. I'd like to acknowledge and thank Ngāti Rehua, several people there, but especially Rodney Nawaka. Hopefully he's able to make it today. We've been texting backwards and forwards over the last couple of days. So I'm not sure if he's there, but if you are, kia ora, Rodney. I'd also like to thank Kirsty McDonald, who was the amazing videographer on this project. And I'd like to thank Ruth Watson and Robin Kearns, who acted as referees. So I'll be really quick on this because Renee introduced me. I'm Chris McDowall. As Renee noted, I trained as a geographer and I've worked as a scientist, a cartographer, a programmer, and a journalist at different times. The thing, I guess, that was the big project before going to Glenfern that we'd spent several years on, myself and my friend Tim Denis, was a book, an atlas called We Are Here, an atlas of Aotearoa. And this was a book that came out in late 2019 in a very different Aotearoa New Zealand to the one that we have found ourselves in now. But it was a contemporary atlas that explored the country in several, from sort of a range of different perspectives and using a range of different cartographic techniques. And I very much see this work that I'm going to talk to you today as being not an extension of this, but almost a kind of this work in miniature, instead of focused on an entire country, looking at a particular place, and that place being Glenfern and Kōtuku Peninsula. So these are just three maps that I've just flicked past. I'm not going to talk about them in detail, but they variously showed the physical geography of Te Waipounamu, the South Island, lightning strikes across the country, and then the paths that cats make with GPS collars around central Wellington. Most of today though, in fact, all the rest of today, in my part of this talk, I'm going to talk about what I did on Glenfern and what, but I think it's worth kind of just first noting what the residency is. Last year I was selected as the Auckland Council Artist in Residence, and the residency is this amazing program which has been running, I think, for a little over 10 years. Each year Auckland Council selects a person, an artist, to live and work for around 8 weeks, 2 months, at an Auckland Regional Park. It's an incredible opportunity. The artist in residence creates some sort of new work while they were there, influenced in some way by the park, which then the council shares back to the public. And it's been going for a little over a decade, and there's been a range of really incredible and varied artists. This is the YouTube page for the program, and you can go back and see the different documentaries. I think all or most were made by Kirsty McDonald, and they're really outstanding pieces of little miniature documentaries. People in the past have been photographers, writers, musicians, installation artists, and more. Last year, the council chose a cartographer, and that was me. What I did was I went to Glenfern. So this is a map from Google Earth or Google satellite maps. And I'm zoomed in here on the Kōtuku Peninsula. So it's in, for those of you who might know Great Barrier Island, it's in the north. So the majority of the population lives in the south, around either Tryphena or Midlands or Clarris. And then over a series of very large hills and even up through this incredible cloud forest. You come out the other side and you're in Okiwi and then eventually in Fitzroy. And the peninsula where Glenfern is situated is where that white box is wrapped around. And so Glenfern itself is, I've sort of just dotted some lines around it in PowerPoint, but it's an area of park that was that's about 83 hectares, and it's one of Auckland's regional parks. It's sort of the gateway to a much larger rest of a peninsula, 240 hectares, which is all ringed by this by a predator fence or by coastline. The park was established in 1992 by Tony Buzaid, who was a yachtsman and conservationist and businessman. He restored the along with his family and friends, the Fitzroy House and the Glenfern Cottage, and both of those buildings are now in the park rented out as accommodation. I stayed in the cottage for 2 months. Following Buzaid's passing, it eventually became a regional park in 2016, and the Glenfern Sanctuary Trust continues to have a really hands-on role in managing the park and the accommodation. And it's an amazing park. You can stay there in the accommodation. One of the benefits to staying is, and certainly one of the benefits of the residency, is the ability to wander around the park alone after dark. So during the day, there are people visiting, but at night the gates close, and there's just all of this incredible native forest and some little streams and coastal areas to explore. It's incredible. And this is just the last of these sort of maps, just to give you a sense of how it's all divided up. So we've got this peninsula. The sanctuary is down there in the bottom right-hand corner. There's some Department of Conservation land across to the west, and then a couple of private holdings and the Aorama Christian Trust in the north. But all of it is managed by is part of the Kōtuku Peninsula, and the different sort of property owners work together in the pest eradication efforts there. And during my time on the island and working at Glenfern, I was sort of free roaming across the whole of the peninsula. So the peninsula itself has this amazing collection, and Glenfern has these just incredible plants and animals. So there are many, many birds. There are birds everywhere. Aotea is free of possums and hedgehogs and stoats, but there are some rats and cats, I guess, are the major pests on the island. But within the predator fence, and we'll look at some of this in a moment and some of the maps that I made, but there are far fewer rats than there are anywhere else because of the really intensive trapping endeavours which are led by Glenfern. So there's kaka just everywhere. Like, this is literally, this photograph was taken within an hour of me getting there. I'd put my stuff on a table and a kaka was landing and looking up at me. There's chevron skink there, which is a very rare type of native skink. This is one that I just stumbled across on the path one day. They're a beautiful, beautiful reptile. There are rays everywhere. At night, I spent a lot of time, my sleep got really odd over the 2 months. I would often get up around 2 a.m. And go walking in the bush. And there are kokopu and tuna and kura all through the streams up and down the Glenfern loop track. Big puriri moths everywhere, well, not everywhere, but around. An amazing place. The residency was really an amazing experience, and it's nearly it's about 11 months on now, 10 months on, and I'm still working on it. I've got a lot of stuff done, and I'm going to show you a lot of stuff. But I think that this work. I was going to say this work keeps growing, but that's not quite right. It's more that I'm still finding the edges and the nuances of this stuff. And it's perhaps a better way of talking about it is that this work keeps on unfolding. The island is a really magical place. And I don't say that lightly. The whenua and its waters, the trees and plants, the creatures that live there and the people who make their homes there. And I've returned twice now since the residency ended to continue the work. And each time I go back, it opens up a bit more. This summer, COVID permitting, I'm gonna go back to the island again for another 3 weeks, this time staying in the bush at the south of the island. And I'm not quite sure where the work that comes out of the residency will end and the rest of it begins, but what I'm showing you, I consider as being a work in progress, and that what this artist in residency started on Aotea and at Kōtuku is just, it feels like it's just going to keep on growing and growing for me. Yeah, it's an incredible place, and I'm only just starting to get my head around it. Whenever I got lost on this project, I would return to this book by Dennis Woods. It's a narrative atlas of Boylan Heights, which is a suburb in Raleigh, North Carolina. And Wood, he still is a cartography professor, but he, in the very, I think in the early 1980s, maybe the very late 70s, but I think it was the early 1980s, in his first lecturing job, he took his students and they mapped this neighborhood in North Carolina, this little suburb, Boylan Heights, and they created all these different thematic maps of the area, but they were really unconventional. They were maps of stop signs, of the stop and go signs. There were maps of wind chimes, maps of the night sky as seen from particular vantages, maps of how many times places were mentioned in the newspaper, maps of jack-o'-lanterns and the ways that squirrels navigated the power lines. And it ended up being this really intimate portrait of a place. And there's a line or a couple of lines in the introduction that I'm just going to read out to you, because they've become my touchstone on this. And he's talking about his own experiences as a young person starting to become a cartographer. Map making was understood as a trade or as a fee for service profession. The neutral, unbiased, value-free provision of maps for employers or clients who wanted to bomb the land, mine it, drill it for oil, run roads across it, plant suburban subdivisions on it, promote it as a tourist destination, or buy and sell it. Love the land? Don't talk to the cartographers, talk to the poets. But what if map making were an expressive art, a way of coming to terms with place, with the experience of place, with the love of place? And that's what I keep coming back to here, is trying to find ways to create maps of a place to come to terms with it. And a lot of what I'm going to share with you over the rest of this are the maps that I made and the people that I talked to in order to make those maps. I'd set out to do this participatory mapping, and I think it ended up being participatory mapping, but not at all in the way that I had expected. These words from Dennis Wood, which I keep coming back to over and over, they've really informed this. So these are not maps of Glenfern. These were maps which from something I did about 7 or 8 years ago. They're not actually even my maps. They're from a workshop I ran on K Road around participatory mapping, and it was what I thought I was going to be doing on Glenfern. So what I did on K Road was we had an event at St. Kevin's Arcade around DIY mapping, and I made a whole bunch of photocopies of just the blocks around St. Kevin's Arcade, and we talked, a group of us, I think there were about 15, 16, 17 people, something like that, maybe 20 people when I think about it, actually looking at how many maps there are. We talked about cartography and we talked about map making, and we talked about the different sorts of things that you might, we talked about geography. These folks, they went out after we'd had the kind of initial conversation, and they made maps of different aspects of the retail space, or perceptions of safety, or graffiti, or these different kinds of layers of the urban environment. And they were just real rough maps. But each one of them were kind of like this quite, I think they did them in groups of two or three, but these, we ended up with this, in this collection of things that people came back and they presented it to one another and they talked about it. And it was a really neat experience. And that is what I thought was one of the big things I was going to do at Glenfern. And so I actually turned up. I made these like big maps. I wonder if I've got a, no. these big kind of A3, A2 printouts of the sanctuary that I made ahead of time in black and white. And I showed up with them in a map roll, and I would grab a few people and try to make maps with them. And it just didn't work. And I needed another tack. I think part of the reason it didn't work was the maps got in the way of the conversation. Or it's not so much that the maps did, but the necessity to continually stop and write things on the map would actually break the flow. And the folks I was talking to mainly just wanted to talk and occasionally refer to the map, but more often they actually wanted to get out into the environment and show me things. So this approach I abandoned, and I'm going to show you some other things. These are actually some maps that I happened to make while I was there. It's Tim Lovegrove and Bridget, who's one of the park managers. Tim's from the council, and he came out for a short period. And it's sort of an example of the kind of thing that ended up happening. Tim came out to lead the bird counts. So every year, Tim and some others, three other council members, show up at Glenfern and at other sites around Auckland, and they go to these little stations and they sit there in the morning and then again in the afternoon, and they listen and they record the birds. And so this is Tim out in the field. And I went with Tim and just made notes and just talked to him of all of the different things that he would talk about and that he would say. And so this, I'm showing you a few things at the start of things that are things that I still have maps to make. There was so much material, I just haven't quite finished it yet, but I want to give you a sense of what the process looked like. So we went to A1, and there was a grey warbler at Sunset Rock, and there was a kaka, and there was squawking kaka a little way away, and then tuis in the valley. And then at A2, Tim observed about how the tuis was flying and how he can hear the wing beats. But then there's these amazing details, and this is why I haven't made this map yet, because I haven't worked out how to incorporate it in. I've tried it several times, but it's not quite there, although I think I know how to do it. So he talks about how the fantail is like a squeaky wheelbarrow, and a distant shining cuckoo, very distant though. And he started talking about the poet Shelley and Ode to a Skylark, and how at A5, the yellow hammer, how its call sounds like a little bit of bread and no cheese. And so there's all of this kind of amazing rich material, each one of these ascribed to a point on the landscape, that whenever I tried to make a map of it, I ended up just thinking, oh, this notebook is actually better than the map. But it was an example of going out onto the landscape and what happens. Like, I tried to talk to Tim about birds and about place in front of a map, and it just never quite worked. But as soon as I got him into the place, or not got him into it, I followed him as he already went there. It just became so rich. It was amazing to get away from the paper and away from the computer. Similar, this is quite late in the piece, but I've got many pages like this. This is me alone, just in Glenfern, just recording every few minutes what's happening in this spot under in a patch of where are we? Oh, we're near, there's a little spot where there was a ruru, or pork nest, at the top of some kanuka as you're going into more mature native bush. And it's just recording all of the different things that happen there. And again, this is something which I haven't made the map of yet, but it gives you a sense of what I was doing out there. It was just going and sitting and watching and observing and trying to then bring something back that I could share with others. And very similar, this is with a bunch of really amazing students from our Kiwi school. And we went out walking in the bush and ended up making a map again, which is not quite ready. The rest of the time I'm going to show you maps that are ready. Naming places and talking about the nature of place. And it was incredible to get out of a little lecture theatre or a little classroom and into the bush with these students, and just to talk to them about what they see and how different places connect to one another. But for the rest of the time, and for most of the time, I'm going to just talk to you about a series of people and the maps that that were inspired by them. So Brad and Bridget are the current managers of Glenfern Sanctuary, and they're the people I guess I spent the most time with throughout. They live, and I think they're in this call. In the manager's cottage, which is maybe about a minute's walk from where I was staying, minute and a half. And they are responsible for the day-to-day running of the sanctuary and also for the accommodation there. They maintain the park, they manage the track network and coordinate all the various volunteers. And this is them clearing a tree a few days before I was heading off. It's very tree came down and some bad weather and surprise they got up and needed to take care of it. So that's the kind of thing that often presents a challenge to them in a normal day. This though is this network, this map, which is everywhere if you're working at Glenfern, and it's a map of the track networks. And I was shocked when I was preparing these slides that I didn't actually have a photograph of it, but luckily Kirsty had taken some video of it in her documentary, her little mini doco, and I was able to screenshot it. But what it is it's a map of the track network on across the whole of Kōtuku Peninsula, so not just Glenfern, it extends all the way over. And it was how I found my way around the peninsula, especially as I got over the Glenfern Ridge and into the more remote areas. It was almost kind of like became a sort of my latitude and longitude for navigating. And when Brad and Bridget talk about Glenfern, they'll use these codes. So they'll talk about things like, I'll see you on 300, almost like I would talk about meeting somebody in Kingsland. It's all of these little lines have different numerical codes and little numbers, and it's the way that they coordinate the traps and assign people to do different things and clear different things and record it in their trapping database. So this is one of the maps that I made while I was over there. It's the trapping network effectively. It's that same map that we were seeing just before. You can probably see the same shape of it. And what I've done is I've taken, created a map of all of the different trap lines on Glenfern, both the major trap lines and the minor ones. And then in the 2 months that I was there, I just marked red wherever there was a catch. And the numbers, if you can see those little numbers, I think they go from 1 to 150 something. The order that the catch was recorded in the database, and it blew me away how much they're catching out there in a 2 month period. It's an extraordinary effort, and without what they were doing, there would not be nearly as rich a bird life as is out there. This was, the first of the maps that that I wanted to share with you, and it came out of these conversations with Brad and Bridget, and kind of seeing how they live their lives and almost think and communicate in terms of this network of places, and how central it is to pretty much everyone who works on that peninsula, but also the scale of the work that they're doing there. It's really incredible how dense the network is and how much it is. Just as a little note, down in the bottom right hand corner there are where the buildings are and the gate. That's where you see the kind of the biggest cluster, but it is striking how the rats do just get right up into the island, right up into the peaks. It blows me away. So Brad and Bridget are the current managers of the park, but I also had a lot to do with, or a fair bit to do with, the previous park managers, who are Chris and Sarah. They're no longer at Fitzroy. They live over the hill at Okiwi and work for the Department of Conservation. But they have a lot of knowledge about the place, and they were very kind to me and hosted me. My food bag is ringing me, but I'm just going to ignore that. But they were very kind to me and hosted me several times. This is a picture of Chris and Sarah and their dogs, Max and Tui. And I went out into the bush a few times, a couple of times with Sarah and with Bridget, who you saw earlier, and with Sarah's dog, Tui. And I just walk through the bush with her and take recordings of all of her different observations. So, and then I'd get home and I went back to the cottage and transcribe these things, like write them out at first on bits of paper, but then I started transcribing them onto the maps themselves, annotating them on topographic maps. Sarah has a background as an artist, and she has this way of speaking that combines sort of quite stoic observations with like a clear love and knowledge for the bush. One of the things that she said was, of many things, was how it just blows her away that you can just kneel down in a spot and there's just a whole world there. You pick any spot in the bush and look down at your feet and there is this just entire world. And that's something, along with some things from that we'll see in a moment from John Ogden, that really inspired a lot of the stuff that I did. So it became clear how deep her knowledge of the peninsula was and Chris's. Her and Tui, her dog, just seemed to know every inch of that place. And I spent a lot of time looking at aerial photographs of the peninsula, and there's sort of so much of it is covered in trees, which is amazing. But that sort of that green texture actually makes it quite hard to read the landscape and to interpret the shape of it. So this map came out of my wanderings with Sarah and Tui, and their kind of like really intimate knowledge of the whenua. And what I did was I took a what's called a LIDAR data set, this massive cloud of about 4 million points, all shone from lasers. And we're going to see some of these in a different context in a moment. But I took all of this massive cloud of points, and I wrote a little bit of programming code that sort of stripped out all of the vegetation and just looked at the ones that were in any given place that were the closest to the ground, and then created a surface model of the earth. And it's almost like you take this kind of three-dimensional thing, remove all of the things that represent vegetation or buildings or water, and you just ended up with the things that have the kind of reflectivity signature of bare ground. And then I turned that into a surface, which is what you're looking at. Although the surface is a bit strange because there are some tricks there where I've tried to emphasize both slope and height. So the higher an area is, the lighter it is, but also the steeper it is, the darker it is. So I've kind of like trying to highlight both areas that are high and also areas that are flat. And in doing so, trying to show the shape of the land in a way that is not really apparent in any other way, I think, even looking at it on an aerial photograph, it's very difficult to see the kind of the nuance of the texture of the surface of the earth. there. And I'm certain this isn't how Sarah and Tui kind of see it, but it reminds me of my experiences walking with them. John Ogden. John is a professor of botany and ecology, and he was at the University of Auckland for a long time. These days he lives near Midlands, in the south of Aotea. When I was a graduate student in the late 90s and early 2000s, it's actually at a time when I think John was the head of environmental science at Auckland University, and environmental science merged with geography. And so I met him once or twice there, but I was a student and he would have had no memory of me. But as I was driving one day on Aotea, I saw him on the side of the road with a pair of binoculars in a wetland. And it turned out I stopped the car and introduced myself. And it turned out he was watching bitterns. And I talked about what I was doing and asked if he might be available to visit Glenfern sometime. And we sort of did a bit of a trade on something where I gave him a hand with some things in Midlands, and then he came up to Glenfern. And we spent some time walking in the bush, and he taught me a lot of things about ecology on that afternoon. It's not something that I'm trained in. I've read a little bit about ecology, but I don't have the deep knowledge that someone of John's persuasion does. We talked a lot about light wells and vegetation succession and what constitutes a leaf. And I'm going to show you some things that are all stuff that hasn't made it. And then I'll show you what I did do from John. So these are all kind of exploratory bits of work that I did. Again, this is LIDAR data. So this is the same source data as what went into that. but it's me looking at it in its much rawer form. And I was doing a lot of work trying to, I still feel like there's something there. This is nothing like I would ever put out. This is very much just exploratory workings. But it's me trying to look at the structure of the canopy, because that's something we talked about a lot, was about time and succession and canopy structure. And so you can sort of see there, in the bottom right-hand corner, there is water and there's some boats in the harbour. And then we've got the pink of the high canopy, and then the purple, which is the kind of like gorses and scrub, although there's also the buildings. And another image, this was a little bit later on, something else that I made looking across Fitzroy, just at raw LIDAR data. We're just looking at raw laser data, but shaded up. In this case, it's not classified by the type of vegetation it is. Instead, it's I was looking at the intensity of the light as it reflects back to the lens on the camera in the aeroplane that passes overhead. And you can see the boats in the harbour, which have a different kind of image signature to the water that they sit on, and the grass and the trees. But it's still, there's something here, but I still haven't reached it yet. And we talked though a lot about small things. And I'd already spent a lot of time looking at, micro landscapes, looking at mosses and lichens. And I often think about there's an exercise that sometimes is set for young geographers where especially in North American universities, where you take a 1 square meter portion of the earth and go out to a field or a bit of forest, and then ask the young cartographers to make a map of that 1 square meter. And it was something that I really, I found myself really drawn to. And I'm going to show you a failed attempt at it in a moment, and then what I actually ended up with. So I took this photograph of the side of a kauri tree, and I was kind of blown away. Again, it harkens back to some of the things that Sarah was saying, where you crouch down and you see an entire world. Like there's an entire ecology going on here of mosses and a climbing rata and fungi and the peeling of the bark of the kauri. And I started kind of just drawing it, like actually tracing it with, and using similar techniques to what you would do in a if you were classifying a large scale landscape, where you draw the forests and the wetlands and the towns and all of the other different types of land cover, except instead of land cover, I was looking at vegetative and fungal and algal communities. And this is something, this took me ages, but it just wasn't quite there. I have abandoned this one for now. I don't think I'll come back to it. But this was a lichen that I spent a long time sitting on top of a rock at the top of the sanctuary. And this lichen, it's difficult to actually see from this photograph, but it's really quite large, like maybe about a meter. It's very exposed, and it would be difficult for anything else to grow in that spot apart from this, maybe some mosses, and you can see there are some mosses around it. But what I ended up doing was spending a lot of time just creating this kind of map of this lichen and treating it as though it was a landscape, a miniature landscape, and looking at the different textures of it and the different almost like micro communities within that kind of symbiosis between the fungi and the algae that constitutes a lichen. And this is one, along with some others that we'll see as a moment, and I'm conscious of time, that is printed. Just two more big ones. Rodney Nowaka is an amazing person, and I was really grateful. We met on several occasions. And each time I think he would stay for longer and longer as we kind of got to know each other. And there's a lot of things I think which we talked about that it's not my place to map those things. But I'm really grateful for the trust that he had in me. But there's one thing that I did take, which I feel comfortable sharing with people. And that was this incredible comment that he made, which was, I'm just reading here a quote from him. "It's the ridge lines that connect us back into our whenua. Look at where Glenfern is. If you look again, the ridges are all connected out to the furthest points of Aotea. So when you look at Herikamata, there are three or four ridge lines that sweep through the whole island. And if you really watch them and not follow the road, they all connect. They'll all come back into another ridge line that throws you back there, that turns you off this way, and that'll drop you down into a valley and connect again, coming out to the points." So that really stuck with me, his observation that the way to understand this, the motu is through its ridge lines, and that's how you navigate this quite difficult curly place. And so I made this map. I'm going to zoom in just so you get a bit more of a sense of it. And it's not just focused on Glenfern and Kōtuku. Instead, it's the entire island, and it's only the ridge lines. I took an elevation model and then wrote a little program that kind of would just drop random points into the landscape and then just follow them up. And through following them up and then kind of adjusting the transparency of these things, they would all eventually come together at a high point. And that's what we see here. And it also really struck me as I was making it, it wasn't intentional, but how much it ended up looking like a moss or a lichen, and how these small micro landscapes are reminiscent of these much, much larger structures. I still feel like there's a bit of work to do on this, but I think it's, yeah, I think there's something here. And then the final thing I wanted to share with you today this is Sunset Rock, which is, this is not my photograph, it's a photograph, I haven't put the credit on it, I'm sorry, I should have put the credit, but I mentioned earlier how it was a great privilege of the residency to be able to wander around and explore the park after hours, and I often was like taking afternoon naps so I could get up at 2 a.m. and go and wander around at night. And on clear nights, the sky is really full of stars, and it's a dark sky sanctuary. And I think about how when you look into the sky, you're actually staring backwards in time, and that you're looking into the past. So the light from the Earth's nearest neighbor, from Alpha Centauri, is about 4 years old. But when we look at, say, the bright star Betelgeuse, we're actually looking at light that is nearly 550 years since it started its journey to reach your eye. And when you look at light from certain parts of the Orion Nebula, that light is about 1300 years old, meaning it started its journey around 677 AD. And then there's some of the very fainter stars that are tens of thousands of years old. And so I made this map of the sky above the sanctuary as it appeared on the night that I arrived, for most of the first week of the residency. Each circle is a star. I'll just zoom in a little bit. Each of these circles is a star, and the larger the star, the brighter it appears in the sky. But the colors indicate how long the starlight has been traveling through space before reaching the Earth. And so those yellow stars, those few yellow stars, are within 10 light years of our planet. So the light is about within 10 years old. But the very darkest stars are over a century old. It's a bit difficult to see on this version. It's just designed for print. And so the colors, they print really well, but it's but on the screen they're a little bit tricky to see. But this is close to what the eye can see, although in terms of each of these stars are kind of visible on the absolute kind of pristine, on a night of absolute kind of pristine conditions in Glenfern. So I'll just pull back again, and it's I guess just also looking at the concept of scale and like light seemed to be something that even though many of these images are really dark, these maps are really dark, light was sort of a part of the technique on almost all of them, except for maybe not the traps and the ridge lines, but anything that involved the LiDAR was all about light bouncing off the surfaces. And this is almost the flip of it. It's about, instead of light that's been sent out, it's light that's been received. Each one of these, I wish that we could have met in person. They're printed up in quite a large format. I'd love to make some adjustments on some of these. It's a difficult thing with print, but one day. But in person, I think that these things sing a little more than they do in a digital presentation like this. But given our current circumstances, I'm grateful that I'm able to share it with you in this way. And I just want to round out just by thanking again the council, the trust, mana whenua, and and Auckland libraries. There is a short documentary that you can find on YouTube about the residency that Kirsty McDonald created, along with and Michelle Edge helped with everything. So thank you, and I think we've got a little bit of time for questions.